Good evening to one and all present here, and heartily welcome to everybody who's joining us online through Facebook, Twitter, and all other social media platforms. My dear friends, today we have a very special event happening in our office in Bangalore today. We have with us former IPS officer and vice president of BJP Tamil Nadu, Sri Annamalai ji. Heartily welcome to you to Bangalore and to our office, sir. I request our MP and Dr. Sandeep, BJYM Karnataka President, to please felicitate Sri Annamalai ji. Thank you, sir. Heartily welcome to our Member of Parliament and Bharatiya Janata Yuva Morcha President, Sri Tejaswi Surya ji also.
So I'm gifting your MP a turmeric that is grown in a farm in Tamil Nadu by a farmer called Saravanan in Sethumalai.
Right.
Nature is organic one, so a gift from Tamil Nadu. And this is our Bharatiya, wonderful
Bharatiya. So in his new role, he needs Bharatiya. So it is for. The trend in politics is changing lately. From Ladakh to Kanyakumari, youth are getting into politics, and BJP is leading this transformation of politics. In this regard, today we have with us Sri Annamalai ji and Tejaswi Surya ji for a very fun-filled discussion which will involve politics, nationalism, different questions. We also have a good gathering here in our office today, and we have multiple questions which are posed online also. So we'll just take it forward from there. To start with, Annamalai ji, a question for you. You were a cop, you were in the system, you were in the government. Being in the system, you quit the service, you come to politics. And I'm pretty sure you see a significant role that needs to be played by youth in politics today. How do you see the youth engagement in politics today across the country? What are your views regarding that?
It's a very simple data that we have. The median age of the Indian population is very low, probably about upwards of 32, 33, 34. And Tejaswi Surya ji, our MP himself, is a very prime example. When leaders of that age come and connect with the bulk of the voters are below 40. So you represent their aspirations directly without any hindrance. So that is the first positive thing I see. When you compare with other political parties, BJP as a party, It is one step ahead of how the country is changing. It is always one step ahead. It finds youth of great potential, gives them positions, accelerates them, and makes sure that other youths, they revolve around them. That's how the party has grown, right from 1950 till now in its different avatars. And I believe India itself is becoming an aspirational country. It's becoming an aspirational country. No more people wanted to take things lying down. Everybody is aspirational. And when youth represent that aspirational class, come and sits in positions of power. I see your youth adhyaksha here. I see all the youth people here. I see all people not connected to politics, but still 20, 30 of them sitting in this MP's office, which is a role model office, I believe. There is a group of youth sitting there running projects on behalf of the MP. Another group of youths doing internship here. This is unlike an MP office. This is more like a corporate office. But here, only because they got connected to a youth, and maybe they're not associated with the political party, but they're still getting the things done. That's a larger canvas in which I see things, youth and politics in India.
Right. That's a very interesting answer on, you know, how youth, when they come into politics, other young people in the country will connect. I guess we have the next question from one of our people who are sitting in the audience. In any case, I'll just carry forward. Probably we'll take that question. So, Tejaswi, this is a question to you also, being in mainstream politics and electoral politics. Youth getting into politics is a very good thing, we all agree. But there is a very significant question which is posed online also by multiple people. Getting into politics in their 20s, early 30s is a very challenging thing for people who come from middle class or lower class of the society. People who come from the rich class, you know, they don't have to worry about anything else. They can do social work, they can be on the field, get into politics. But for a guy who's in a middle class family or a lower middle class family or a poor background, it's always a question for him on whether to come into politics and work here or, you know, earn the bread for house. How do you see that a youth who's from a middle class or a lower middle class family in today's scenario getting into politics in his late 20s or early 30s? What is your take on this?
Thank you, Sumukh. Yelrugu namaskara. Modulnedagi ivattu namma kacherige namma Bengaluru Dakshina Lokasabha Sabha kshetrakke namma aatmiyaragiruvanta Karnataka singam antane khyati padadantaha ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತು ತಮಿಳುನಾಡಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಎರಡೂ ಕಡೆ ಜನರ ಭಾವನೆಗಳನ್ನು ಮನಸ್ಸನ್ನು ಗೆದ್ದು ಯಾವ ತಮಿಳುನಾಡಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಬಿಜೆಪಿ ಅಧಿಕಾರಕ್ಕೆ ಬರಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಬಹಳ ಕಷ್ಟ ಅಂತ ಜನ ಮಾತನಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರುವಂಥ ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲೂ ಕೂಡ ತಮಿಳುನಾಡಿನಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಭಾರತೀಯ ಜನತಾ ಪಾರ್ಟಿಯ ಸರ್ಕಾರವನ್ನು ಅಸ್ತಿತ್ವಕ್ಕೆ ತರ್ತೇವೆ ಎನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ರಣಧೀರನ ಛಲವನ್ನು ಹಿಡಿದು ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಹೊರಟಿರುವಂಥ ಅಣ್ಣಾಮಲೈ ಅವರಿಗೆ ನಾನು ಪ್ರಥಮವಾಗಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕಚೇರಿಗೆ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರಕ್ಕೆ ನಾನು ಸ್ವಾಗತವನ್ನು ಕೋರ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇನೆ. ಬಹಳ ಸಂತೋಷ ಆಯಿತು. ಈ ಸಂವಾದವನ್ನು ದೇಶದಾದ್ಯಂತ ಜನ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಯಾಕೆ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಅಣ್ಣಾಮಲೈ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಕೇವಲ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದಲ್ಲಷ್ಟೇ ಅಲ್ಲ, ತಮಿಳುನಾಡಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇರೆ ಕಡೆ ಕೂಡ ಬಹಳ ಜನ ಯುವಕರು ಅವರನ್ನು ಫಾಲೋ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಈ ಸಂವಾದವನ್ನು ನಾವು ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ ಭಾಷೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನುವಂಥ ಒಂದು ಅನಿವಾರ್ಯತೆ ಇದ್ದಿತ್ತು. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಸಂವಾದವನ್ನು ಇಂಗ್ಲೀಷ್ ಭಾಷೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಮುಂದುವರಿಸ್ತೇವೆ. ಖುಷಿ ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಅಣ್ಣಾಮಲೈ ಅವರು ಡಿ ಸಿ ಪಿ ಆಗಿದ್ದು ಕೂಡ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಸೌತ್ನಲ್ಲೇನೆ, ಅದು ನಮಗೊಂದು ಬಹಳ ಸಂತೋಷದ ಸಂಗತಿ. ಅದರಿಂದ ಒಂದು ವಿಶೇಷವಾದಂಥ ಅಭಿಮಾನ. ಇನ್ನೊಂದು ಅಂತಂದರೆ ಅವರು ಅದರ ಹಿಂದಿನ ಪೋಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ ಇದ್ದಿದ್ದು ಚಿಕ್ಕಮಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ, ಅದು ನಮ್ಮೂರು. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಅವರು ಅಲ್ಲೂ ಆಗಿಂದನೂ ನಮ್ಮ ಒಂದು ಸಂಬಂಧ ಇದೆ. ಆದ್ದರಿಂದ ಅದೊಂದು ಬಹಳ ಸಂತೋಷ. ಸುಮುಖ್, ಯು ಪಾಯಿಂಟೆಡ್ ಅ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್. ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ನೋ ಈಸಿ ಆನ್ಸರ್ ಟು ದಿಸ್. Politics, unfortunately, in the last so many years, has become a rich man's game. And because it's become a rich man's game, it is also being infected only by dynasty politics. And this is a vice versa cycle. Politics is rich, politics is expensive. And you have to spend money, which is why only those people who can spend that kind of money can get into politics. And who are those young people who can spend that kind of money? Those kind of people who inherit that kind of money. And who are the people who can inherit that kind of money? The ones whose father or grandfather has made money through politics, they are the ones who can come into politics. This is the sad state of affairs in India's politics today. So forget contesting elections. A person coming from a middle class family, I wouldn't even go to the lower middle class or poor background people. Even coming from families where parents are in service jobs, people are in monthly salaried jobs, their children cannot even dream of becoming MLAs, MPs. My story is an exception. But we need more of these exceptions to become the norm. And we need more and more stories of Narendra Modi, who comes from the most poor families and who shows that they can rise to the highest of offices. That should become the norm. And today I do not see any other political party other than the Bharatiya Janata Party effectively pushing for reforms, whether it is electoral reforms, whether it is intra-party democracy, whether it is encouraging young people in politics. No other party is encouraging these things. So what happens is, the ones who are karyakartas will remain karyakartas all their life. The ones who are children of political leaders, they become leaders overnight. Because you have baap ka paisa to invest in politics. So until and unless we break this chain and encourage young people to take up mainstream electoral politics, and that is not an easy job, we need electoral reforms which will make elections less expensive and more affordable to people. Unless those systemic changes happen, this will not go a long way. This is not just in politics. I was talking to a friend of mine who is working in the movie industry, an aspiring actor. The same thing happens even in Bollywood, happens in other media industries. We have been witnessing, after Sushant Singh Rajput's death, we were hearing debates of nepotism. What is nepotism? You may be a great actor, you may be extremely talented, you will keep on giving hundreds of auditions every day and keep getting rejected. Whereas another person whose father is an actor, he will say, hey, you can take my daughter or take my son in your movie, cast him in your movie. I will give 10% stake or 15% stake and I will also produce the movie. That is why those people who do not have this kind of money will not get opportunities to become great actors. So if you look at Bollywood, if you look at Telugu movie industry, Kannada, any movie industry, you will find generations of generations, you know, actors' families. Grandfather was actor, father was actor, now the child is also actor and the grandchildren is also becoming, you know, child artists. Does that mean that there are no other capable people, talented people who can emote well, act well in those industries? Of course there are, but they don't get an opportunity. The same way, are there no capable leaders? Is there no better young leader than Tejaswi Yadav in whole of Bihar? Are there no young political leaders than M.K. Stalin in Tamil Nadu? Of course there are hundreds and hundreds of capable young people, but they do not get platforms and opportunities. One Annamalai has come today in Tamil Nadu who will take Tamil Nadu by storm and show what people like M.K. Stalin in their place. That is the kind of change that we need. So all of us, my commitment as the national president of the Yuva Morcha is to bring more and more young people coming from the most modest of backgrounds, most humblest of families, and make them the strongest of leaders for the country. And together as young people, as educated audience, educated young people of the country, we must push for electoral reforms that our Prime Minister is speaking about. Whether it is one nation, one election, whether it is one nation, one electoral rolls, whether it is state funding of elections, electoral bonds, all of these are systemic reforms aimed at making elections more transparent and more less expensive, which will bring more young people into the country. So this is what we should all do. It's a big task, but if we can't do it, nobody else will do.
Well, that's a very interesting topic that you have opened up. Reducing the cost of elections and increasing the youth participation. I think an agenda or a topic can be started just on this. And, you know, if the discussion goes forward, it's going to bring a fundamental change in the way politics happens in this country. I think we have one more question from one of our audience.
Yeah, very good evening, Tejaswi sir and Annamalai sir. So my question is open for both of you. It's like, for the women in politics, what are you both going to do for that, or what are you going to do in the future and now?
It's a fact that the women of India are voting for Narendra Modi ji in large numbers over the last 2-3 years, if we see. Women are shifting towards Narendra Modi ji. From there, I'll answer your question, ma'am. The reason is two reasons main. One is, politics was always an insecure field for women, frankly speaking. Especially if you come to Tamil Nadu, Dravidian politics, you see, they never felt safe. Only after Jayalalitha became very powerful, women started congregating towards the ADMK. Now Jayalalitha is no more. The reason, if you ask me, why is this happening? Politics being masculine, it being powerful, it being a money-oriented business, like what he exactly portrayed. Any woman who was shining in politics either should have had a great family background or some powerful guy backing up. That's how it was. Now what has happened? The way India is progressing now, maybe from 1990, accelerated after Modi ji is in power 2 times now. One, women are coming out in large numbers, especially to BJP. Now we just finished our Vel Yatra in Tamil Nadu. We are very surprised, actually, the president and me and a couple of people are traveling with him throughout the state. Half the crowd is women. Among the half the crowd, women crowd, we felt close to 40% of women crowd are not connected to the party. They're not party workers. First time they're coming and seeing what is a Vel Yatra, what is BJP doing. When we spoke to a couple of people, they said, look, there is always a pent up emotion inside to get into politics. But till now, I never felt safe coming out. For the first time, I'm coming out to see what BJP is doing in Vel Yatra. This is a common occurrence across Tamil Nadu. Now the main thing for people like Tejasvi Surya ji and other people who occupy high post in BJP is to make sure, which you already said, is to bring positions of power where women can sit, which BJP is of course doing it. If you see this as a party, for example, the national president of BJP Women's Wing is a lady from our state. If I can take Vanathi Srinivasan as an example and answer, she was just like most of the women and Insecure, came through AVBP, contested elections. But party always have got a knack of finding good women. They'll always make them sit in good post. One, you have to trust the party. The second point I'm trying to convey is, yes, women are coming out in large numbers. They trust BJP. It's an open process. Nobody will scuttle you. Nobody will kai and there's no demigod above you. And you do not please anybody like being in a movie industry. Now, the second thing, you got to trust the party to take care of you. Just like women, they are trusting the party with their votes. Now, this is the time you got to trust the party. You need to stick for a little bit more longer time. You need not wait for 1 year, I've come, nothing I'm getting, can I leave the party now? Just be patient for some more time. Big roles are opening up. In fact, if you look at CCS itself, Nirmala Sitharaman, madam, is a classic example. From Tamil Nadu, from Andhra, MP, Rajya Sabha MP from Karnataka. So now people have to be a little bit patient. Party will reward you. Roles are opening up. Democracy itself is getting more matured. And last but not the least, Narendra Modi ji is emerging as the single largest PAN leader across India, where women for the first time are reposing their trust on a national leader. It hasn't happened before anywhere, from Bihar to Telangana to Tamil Nadu. Thank you.
Tejasvi, your views on this topic?
Very quickly, because you summarized everything so effectively. I think there has to be an active interest taken at every levels. In fact, after I became the national president of the Yuva Morcha, I reminded all Yuva Morcha cadre across the country that this party, the Bharatiya Janata Party, among its founding members, had Vijay Mate Vijay Raje Sindhya as its founding member. And she was such a feisty, strong woman that when time came for the party, when party couldn't muster funds and resources, she pledged her personal wealth, her personal jewelry, raised resources for the party and contributed to the building of the Bharatiya Janata Party. That's the kind of heritage that the BJP has in terms of women leaders. So I think three things primarily has to be done. One, active interest needs to be taken, especially in the youth wing, to bring more and more women into the party's forum. So wherever it is, the national office bearers, whether it is the mandal office bearers, at every level, more young women have to be given opportunities to come. Two, whether it is economics, politics, social, like the Constitution of India says, we must strive towards creating equality of opportunities. So opportunity needs to be created to people. So I think that's the second thing that we must focus on. And the third thing is, with more financial independence that is coming in the way of, that women are getting these days, they're getting into new jobs, aspirational jobs. It is only a matter of time that women will take leadership positions and emerge as strong leaders, both inside and outside of the party. And it's a great, great sign of the modern and changing times that even in Bihar elections, which Annamalai ji very rightly mentioned, the polling percentage of women is 10% more than the polling percentage of men in the country. And if you look at how women vote, women are far more sensitive voters, far more responsible voters, and far more long-term thinking voters than men folk, which is why the Prime Minister was rewarded for his works. And let me also tell you, my visits in Bengal, I am seeing a large number of women coming out on the streets. When women come out on the streets and start supporting a political party or stand against a particular Andolan, then you can take it from me that no force on earth can stop the change from happening. Even in West Bengal, which is the land of the Shakti, the women folk of West Bengal are actually leading the fight for the BJP. And in 2021 April, when the new elections will happen, you can take it from me, the percentage of women polling in West Bengal will also be higher than men, and that is going to bring in a Narendra Modi BJP-led government in West Bengal. So we must make an effort to actively promote young women leadership.
Thank you, both of you. It's very interesting that people in power, like yourselves, are actively engaging and actively working towards bringing more women into the system. I'm sure this is going to lead to a very solid base for women to get into the politics in the near future. We have one more question from the audience here to Annamalai ji.
Hi sir, myself Santosh. Congrats both of you for leading the party in such a great things. What was the tipping point for you to join politics?
Tough question. Santoshji, thank you for that question. A lot of people keep asking me. Maybe it is an opportunity for me to clarify once for all. There was never a single tipping point, frankly speaking. Never a single tipping point. I wanted to be a businessman. I went to IIM Lucknow for my MBA. So something I saw in Lucknow pushed me towards civil services. We're part of many projects, especially in the Purvanchal side, Bihar and UP border, where a lot of kids were dying before they became 1 month old as well. Malnutrition, a lot of things. We investigated, we did some radio jingles for them. Slowly, it pushed me towards civil service career. Civil service, if you do it with sensitivity, and empathy, the job that you sit, especially as a cop, your mind opens up to a lot of things. People suffering, the way people express their life to you, the way people open up to you. So instead of a single tipping moment that happened, I can recall about maybe about 10, 15 instances right now over the last 4 or 5 years that slowly pushed me, slowly accelerated the process to get into politics. I still vividly remember the case in Udupi where a 10th standard child was raped and killed near Baindur. So subsequent investigation, we caught the accused, that's fine. But why did it happen? Can we do something about the society per se? It only happened because the child has to walk to a school and come back about 4 kilometers up and down. And now we can't blame the government because the government with its limited resources can only mobilize that much. So is there a better way other than policing to go and solve it? Or every time you see a road traffic accident, especially when the kids of their age and my age, when they die, we can't answer to their parents. We can say that we have put that barricades, we have put whatever it is, but still can we put effective policy measures in place to prevent people from dying? Suicides, taking care of old age people. Do we have enough social security laws in place? You minus the last 6 years, you just take out from 2014 onwards. Before 2014, if you see, India as a country was having the least amount of social security net for its people. Absolutely zero. By chance you are born into a poor family, you get sick, nobody can take care of you. What can a police do or an IAS officer do? Thanks to the 5 lakh insurance system that we have now, to the Honorable Prime Minister G, even a poor guy need not fear any disease because 5 lakh is there. Thanks to Jan Dhan accounts, the money is coming. So these are all policy measures where people in positions in power, elected representatives can get it done. So my book is coming out in about 2 weeks from now. I've written a book, all these things I've mentioned. So rather than the tipping point, I would say it's more about 10 instances. Then it accelerated my Kailash trip in 2018, where I had spent about 57 days up in the Himalayas and in Tibet. So that crystallized my thought process. It said, okay, can I go for a slightly higher calling? Can I go more grassroots? And also in bureaucracy, with all due respect to my batchmates and other people, it's a great field to be in service. But I felt the more higher up you go, if you're not very open to life, you start getting disconnected from people at the grassroots. So you go sit in big AC offices, you keep moving up. So I didn't want that to happen to me consciously. I know it's a very risky decision, it's a very bold decision, whichever way you look at it. I don't put risky word to that. I see it as life's calling. So where life takes you, you put your heart to it. So you'll be of help to some other person in your life. That's the way I see it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for very candidly opening up about your journey into politics. And also one very important point that you mentioned about bureaucracy, as people move up, their connect with the ground keeps going up. I think that's a complete debate and a discussion in itself that we'll have to start shortly. Taking the conversation to a lighter side from here, you were known as the Singham, the angry cop of Karnataka. You were carrying that anger when you were a cop. Now that you have come into politics, do you still carry the same anger? And also, I'd just like to mention, there's a very big complaint from a lot of your fans that you never smile ever. So, so your take on that.
I'm sure our Tejasvi ji will agree with P. There is a leadership called situational leadership. So many a times you sit in a role, you sit in a position, and then you got to make sure that dharma is upheld in that position. So cop is always about a straight white and a straight black. You look at what is right, what is wrong, you implement it. There's no question of gray there. And I don't believe in the modern policeman saying there is a gray area. No. Constitution is very clear, especially people of executive role. You don't have any business to operate in gray area, white or black. So you do it. Now, as a politician, it's entirely different, because what happens is it's like 10 fingers in life. You see 10 different people in same day, but everybody is right from their own perspective. People have put their heart and soul to the party 30, 35 years, and people got every right to come and get here. Maybe the arguments like look stupid to us, but not to them, because they have got every right to come and present their argument. So politics, one thing I felt in the last 3 months, it requires enormous amount of patience. Second, it requires enormous amount of sensitivity. And third, it requires an enormous amount of taking failures, taking setback, and taking negative criticism. I know, especially the MP. I've been seeing him from his campaigning and 2019. I've seen him from his campaigning to winning an MP and growing. So if you ask me what made Mr. Tejaswi Surya, I would say negative criticisms made him. So the kind of thing people threw at him in the first 2 months, 3 months of his political career, very young, how can somebody at 27 be MP, and how can a party trust a person like him in South Bangalore, the general comments that was made online or offline as well. But I think he grew from strength to strength. That very few people have that thing. So there's three qualities we got to have. You overwork, you keep working hard, you convert all those adversity to a positivity. So these are very tough lessons. It is not that you speak in the mic, you go and get it. The reason I'm being slightly more open today is, I don't want people who see this thing to get a false sense of perception. The guy who's sitting here, there's risen through his hard work. We all know 27 he became MP, but people don't know what he put in 7 years before that, what he put in 8 years before that. We have seen photographs of him going and sitting in road doing strikes when at the age of 22, 23, nobody would dare do it. Now you see Bengal, what is he doing? Just going there, it's very tough, absolutely tough. As a cop, I see when a person having a Z-plus security going, when there's no police escort car in the front, when they planned the route so badly that you allow the Trinamool Congress cadres to enter into this lane and people surround our party president's car. So they're in the harm's way. Everybody is in the harm's way in Bengal. Any leader who's going, tear gas shells get thrown like a tomato. People just throw it like that. It's like a war zone. So it needs that kind of pedigree. So people have it. I think politics will make sure they go to the place where they're destined to go. That's how I look at it. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Continuing the conversation on politics and your political career in Tamil Nadu, we have a couple of questions regarding Tamil Nadu politics asked. I think Arvind will.
Ide online la nariya questions comment panni kekkuradhu. Brinda, Chandramouli, Venkatesh Narayan, appuram Ramya, naalu per ketirukanga. Adukapram innoru or additional question. Tamil Nadu la BJP eppo government form pannalam? அப்புறம் தமிழ்நாடுல பிஜேபி வந்த அப்புறம் டாப் ஃபைவ் ப்ரையாரிட்டிஸ் என்ன இருக்கணும்? வேற டிரவிடியன் பாலிடிக்ஸ் மாதிரி இருக்குமா இல்லை நேஷனலிஸ்டிக் பாலிடிக்ஸ் இருக்குமா?
ஓகே, ஜஸ்ட் டு ஆன்சர் திஸ் இன் இங்கிலீஷ், தேங்க்யூ பிருந்தா அண்ட் டீம் ஃபார் ஆஸ்கிங் திஸ் க்வெஸ்டன். த க்வெஸ்டன் இஸ் ஹவு டஃப் இஸ் ஃபார் பிஜேபி டு கெட் இன் டு தமிழ்நாடு பாலிடிக்ஸ்? ஐ திங்க் சேம் க்வெஸ்டன் தேர் ஆஸ்கிங் இன் பெங்கால் 5 years பேக். அவர் எம்பி ஹஸ் ஆன்சர்ட் தட் come what may, in April, May, we are going to form government in West Bengal. No power on earth can stop us. The same thing in Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu, I would answer in two ways. 2021 is the place where BJP is going to lay its foundation. We are going to get into assembly with a sizable number. And 2026, we are going to be in power. Now, again, for the typical, for my typical Dravidian friends who say, no, it's not possible and all those things. Only one data I have. 40% of Tamil voters are below 39 years of age. So it is his team who are very active in Tamil Nadu, especially our youth wing. And second, they are not connected. How can somebody accept M.K. Stalin ji or his son Uday Nidhi, who has acted in a couple of movies? How can people connect to leaders like that? You come in a bicycle, you act in the movies, you come and say, I hate Hindi. They act in movies which gets dubbed in Hindi. The same Tamil production house will do it, owned by their family. And they put a t-shirt called Hindi Theriyadha Poda. So first time you see, this is a normal thing. And of course, he acts with North Indian heroines. That's a different issue. Again, they dub whatever is happening in the movie. Now, what is happening actually is people are reading through the line. The Dravidian lie or so-called Maya that was in existence thanks to Karunanidhi's eloquent speech and Anna's eloquent speech. No more, because Stalin cannot even speak without a paper in hand. That's our first weapon. So more than BJP growing, so they are themselves getting decimated. So along with it, BJP is growing. So two things are happening together. And next is simply Narendra Modi ji. If I give you a data, you'll be amazed, sir. You'll be amazed. 1 crore and 6 lakh Tamil people have got their Jandan accounts out of 8 crore. And 54 lakh Tamil farmers, we have given 6,000 rupees in PM Kishan. And 32 lakh Tamil women, after Modi ji has come, first time they are using LPG stove to cook, Ujwala. If you come add all this data, this is much, much greater than the so-called Dravidian concept of social justice. Whatever fraud justice they have done over the years, if you look at, they can't speak with numbers. First time we speak with numbers. So this is why I'm very, very confident, thanks to all the leaders at the national level, thanks to leaders at the state level, thanks to our president also, Murugan ji. We have broken a lot of caste barriers in Tamil Nadu. So I'm very confident 2026 will be sitting in power. Answering the second question, for a person who's asking this question, they know BJP is not a single man party. It's a party of principles, ideologies and all those things. And no single person decides. So it is always a collective decision making. So what are the first 5 priorities? Of course, we keep telling this in stages, our president also. It is to bring nationalist spirit to Tamil Nadu. Very proudly we will say that. Because why nationalist spirit? Because I feel with a lot of shame when our Tamil people get into Mysore just to get a seat in Kendra Vidyalaya or just to get a seat in Navodaya school. And then they ask us to recommend to our Karnataka friend MPs that please ask them. We feel very shameful. At the same time, the Tamil MPs who claim that Kendriya Vidyalayas and Navodaya should not come into Tamil Nadu, or Navodaya should not come into Tamil Nadu, Kendriya Vidyalaya is there. They are the first people to write to the Kendriya Vidyalaya Ministry asking for the 10 seats in their MP quota, including Kanimoli, who will talk in the mic that nationalism should not come to Tamil Nadu. So Navodaya, we don't have. Navodaya, who benefits from Navodaya? I've seen in Hebri, I've seen in Chikmagalur, all those places. So these are our first priorities to make sure all those things Tamil Nadu should get its rightful share. The remaining, you know, whatever is happening in Karnataka, so-called aspirational politics. Tamil Nadu is more about appeasement politics, more about freebie politics. So because of which the state has become a burdened state with 4 lakh crore debt and 70,000 crore net borrowing, all those things. So we are very able people. So they just have to trust us that the government will be in good hands, a collective decision-making body in line with its principles and ideologies. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. I'm sure with the speed that you are going, you know, we'll be in power soon and we'll be able to make a huge difference in Tamil Nadu. One of our volunteers also has a question for you.
Namaste, Tejaswi ji. Vanakkam, Annamalai ji. I just want to ask this interesting question to you. How has your life changed after getting into politics?
Totally, completely, upside down. Now, two things, brother. The thing is, the party has trusted me with the same way the party has trusted Tejaswi Surya ji with a responsibility. Now, to stay true to that responsibility, we got to overwork. There's no other option. A state like Tamil Nadu, we just have to overwork. So what has happened in the last 20 days, if you count, I hardly go to home 2 days out of 20 days. So a lot of travel. So because of which fitness and a lot of things I love, reading, everything has taken a backseat. But it is for a larger cause. At the same time, the positive part, I never felt I'm truly connected to a cadre like the way I feel connected now. So you eat in somebody's home. You get an opportunity to sit with him. Maybe in the party's hierarchy, you could be a small guy. But when you sit with him for 30 minutes, the kind of ideas they give, the spark is somewhere there at the ground. So negatively speaking, time management has become a problem. Positively, the love people have for BJP, the love people have for Modi ji. That is why we are trying our best to steal the Yomocha president to Tamil Nadu. So we were supposed to come to Kanyakumari, but the cyclone played spoiled sport. So the youth are very much coming towards BJP. So once we have an icon like our MP, it's a matter of time. He will accelerate the 6 years to 5 years. So 1 year he will reduce if he's able to spend more time there. So we'll be doing it. We'll be doing it. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Taking the question to little fun side again. Just before this...
But this question did not look like fun questions.
No, we so this I think you'll enjoy. Just before this, you know, both of you were sitting inside and deciding on the football match that both of you are going to play right after this thing. Could you give us some insight about football of both of you? Tejaswi, probably.
I've been playing football right from my school. Our friend Arvind is a star player of our office. So in fact, there's a place where we play football, which Annamalaiji had inaugurated. So that's where we go and play. So today when he was here, we just thought that maybe after this program, we all could go and play a game of football, which he kindly agreed to. So it's important to, especially as young people, play a sport. It helps you, play, understand team spirit, understand victory and loss. The usual thing, but football is a fun game. So I think it was you gave me an easy question and you gave him a hard question earlier. So,
right.
Just,
so
just to add to it,
yeah, please.
I tried all sorts of reasons not to play football today. He said, I'm wearing a dhoti. He said, he has arranged a shot. I said, I'm not wearing a shoe. He said, shoe is ready. So no excuses, but having said that, sport is a sport. So look forward to play with this team.
Yeah. I'm sure a lot of other people would also want to get an update after the game of what happened. A quick rapid-fire kind of question. I'm sure I'm making it tough for you again. Which is your favorite city, Chennai or Bangalore?
Both. Politically, Chennai.
Tejaswi, which victory do you think you'll enjoy? Victory against Mamata Banerjee or OIC?
In April against Mamata Banerjee and in 2023 against OIC.
Annamalaiji, interesting thing, you know, again I'm putting you in a tough spot. Who yields more power, cop or a politician?
Nobody, citizen.
Great. Tejaswi, which sweet do you like, Rasgulla or Mysore Pak?
This is a politically sensitive question. To eat Rasgulla, to gift Mysore Pak.
Okay, question to both of you. Who's your favorite? First Annamalaiji, then Tejaswi. Who's your favorite, Modi or Amit Shah?
I think some questions don't have an answer. You should be intelligent enough to accept it. Technically both.
Oh, Tejaswi?
I was thinking maybe I could bypass
no,
that.
No.
Modi and Amit Shah are like two sides of the same coin. So you toss the coin, one heads is Amit Shah, tails is Modi, so you know it's the same thing. So you like Amit Shah, you like Modi, you like Modi, you like Amit Shah. So you like both of them.
Confused so, you more than the question that was asked.
Yeah, certainly. So, taking it back to our conversation that we were having, you've come into politics very recently, being a bureaucrat. I'm sure you've seen both sides of the life. And even Tejaswi has come into electoral politics recently, but he's been, in the political sphere for quite some time. This question is common to both of you. One of you can answer. What do you think are the three most important values and qualities that a politician, a young politician especially, must carry today?
The three qualities for a young politician, I would say the number one is to have the clarity why is he in politics. So a lot of people don't have clarity and they have very confused clarity. Maybe instead of saying don't have, they have a confused clarity. Is it to better themselves? Is it to see the taste of power? Is it to help people? Whichever way it is. The first is to have a sense of clarity. Second, I would say, is to have patience. And politics is a game of patience. Nothing happens overnight. And nobody has come up overnight. Tejaswi Suryaji never came overnight. Modi ji never came overnight. Somehow I believe the youth of this generation, including me, we are more towards the impatient side than on the patient side. So they got to be patient, trust the process, not focus on the results much. The third I would say is to look at long term. Politics in India is completely bad, including what has happened in the Farm Act. We are seeing the protest and everything is because last 70 years of politics was always a backward looking and a short term oriented politics. Suddenly when Modi ji in the last 6 years talks about forward looking, non-appeasement, long term orientation, the vested interests try to play spoiled sport. So this is the time the youngsters like us, all of us, have to bring that long term perspective to our policy planning or whatever we speak. So there's three things I would say: clarity, second patience, and a long term orientation.
Well, brilliant 3 points. So I wouldn't repeat it. I would just want to complement it by three other points, which I think. One, I think politics, by its very nature, teaches you to be indifferent to the results of your work. So the philosophy of karmanye vadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana, that is something that you experience in politics every day. You work towards something, but results will not happen. You do something today, but you intend the things to go this way, but many times it will not happen. There are going to be personal successes, there are going to be personal failures. So how can you remain unaffected by these things? How can you mold yourself to be a person where you can give your 100% effort, but be indifferent to personal glory? This philosophical approach towards life as such and towards politics as a mission is something that any aspiring young political leader must cultivate. So this is the first thing, where you understand that you are here for a larger impersonal ideal and not for a very limited and narrow personal glory. I think this is the first thing that will give you a lot of strength. Second, to add to the long-term planning that Annamalai ji spoke about, as young people, we bring in a lot of understanding of technology. I think that is something that we must, as young political leaders, bring to the table. Technology is a game changer in governance, and you are in politics for governance. If you look at the post-COVID challenges, understanding of big data, understanding of algorithms, how using technology and big data and artificial intelligence for governance, how say new emerging technologies like blockchain can be implemented in say cleaning of land records. So these, this technological bent of mind, which the older generation political leaders may perhaps not have. I'm not saying that they don't have. Many of them are extremely technologically adept. But as young people, any progressively young generation will be more attuned to technology. If you look at it, when we were kids, we would play with pen and pencil and, you know, geometry box. The kids of today, they play with smartphones. So, you know, that's the progressive technological evolution that has taken place. So I think the second aspect would be bringing in technology perspective to governance. The third thing would be age-old values of integrity, of responsibility, and empathy. Because you're in politics, because you're here to solve everyone else's problem. You are here every day in our office. The morning, Sumuk, you know, every one of us know here. Morning we come here, the office starts at 9. By the time we close at 10, every single person who walks into the office walks in because he has a problem. And he is not here wanting to hear technical solutions or technical explanations. He wants a solution. So you need to be empathetic to that person. And I think these are age-old qualities which are universal for all political leaders across the world. And I think these are the three important qualities any young aspiring political activist must have.
That's a very, philosophical and whatever Annamalai ji said, even that is a very comprehensive thing that young guys must inculcate, whether to get into politics or into social work or even to lead a very quality life. Taking this forward, lately we are seeing a very big trend of young guys, young girls supporting BJP, supporting nationalistic politics in social media, in different blogs and other things. To take this further, to strengthen this mindset and to get them to work at grassroots levels, what are some of the books, resources, or podcasts both of you would suggest? This is a again an audience generated question, because most of them wanted to know what they have to read, what they have to listen, what they have to understand to strengthen their ideology, to strengthen their commitment towards the society. What books, podcasts, or resources would you suggest, both of you?
I'm not a big fan of the podcast, but the only podcast I listen is Tim Ferriss Show. I listen it off and on. But otherwise, remaining, I feel it's too kind of long for a person kind of thing. Tim Ferriss, I like. And for the books, yes, he himself is a huge reader of books. I would say for youngsters having an aspirational political career, I would tell them two books that I'm reading now currently. One is Barack Obama's The Promised Land, which has just come out. And we all see Barack Obama becoming a president at 45 and two-term president and all those things. But actually what made Barack the Barack, the president, is the work that he did as a community organizer in the land of Chicago and the steel mills, the closed mills, from Harvard Law School coming there, and that silent work they did, the 10 years of groundwork they put, which propelled them to a position of power. And it is not a position of power. Since you had that grounding and understanding of issues, you're able to make sensible decisions. If you look at Hillary Clinton's book, The Hard Choices, like the MP said, when you sit in his place as an MP or as a national president of Yuva Morcha, it is all hard choices you make. Nothing is easy in politics. The more higher up you go, every choice looks easy, looks tough, but you got to pick the best out of that. Hard Choices, the book itself is named Hard Choices. So when people read a lot of these books, one thing they would get clarity is what we spoke about patience, put that hard work in the ground. And second, it's a Game of Thrones, not the Game of Thrones variety of what we see in the TV, the Game of Thrones because it is not a very smooth path to walk. Like you said, 100 people walk in, you always find a way to give them a solution. But you have to break your own head. If the government is not working, make it functional, make it work and all those things. So last but not the least, I would say pick up your reading also from a field that is away from you, because a lot of cross-functional learning will stimulate your mind more. Like he's quoting blockchain, he's quoting artificial intelligence, algorithm, what is happening. So you can pick up a lot of learnings from startup companies. This office is a classic example of how a MP office is not in India. A person who's standing in the road can see the MP sitting. It is designed in such a way that transparency is maintained from the road. People can see the MP sitting. And that chamber is a place where all non-political people interested in doing social work are sitting. And these are areas where young people like you, including you, you're giving your life for a cause for South Bangalore by doing something that you love. Technology abroad, your live streaming across India. So this is because he's thinking cross-functional. He didn't think like a typical politician how he has to think. So that doesn't come if he reads political books. So read political books to get a grounding. At the same time, pick up books from other fields which will give you a cross-functional life. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tejasvi.
Well, quickly, I wouldn't want to go into a lot of book reading and give syllabus for this thing. But for me, personally, this wall in our office is a very important wall. I call this the ideological pillar of the office. So this wall is where I started my reading. So Ambedkar, Savarkar, Aurobindo, and Chhatrapati Shivaji. So I think these four people, I would suggest any young political activist to read, because reading them will give a very clear idea and understanding of what India is. One person whose big picture we have put inside my chamber is Swami Vivekananda. I started my political, my ideas reading Vivekananda, Aurobindo, and Ambedkar and others. So I think this is a very important reading if you're interested in understanding what Bharat is, what Sanatana Dharma is, what Hindutva is, and you know, having your ideological clarity in mind. Then I think it's very important for young leaders today to read popular science, because science will give you a lot of logical reasoning, understanding, clarity. And it will also give you a key and insight into understanding new developments for the future. So I think Evolution of Cosmos, there's a great book called Cosmos by Carl Sagan, which is one of my favorite books. Richard Dawkins, something that interests me. And I think it's also very important to understand philosophy. I mean, that's something that I like reading. So whether it is Upanishads, whether it is Hiriyanna, whether it is Radhakrishnan, whether it is a lot of Kannada books as well, you know, which has given me a lot of insight into life and philosophy, Bhairappa and Kuvempu and all of these. Those are something that helped us understand life from a very philosophical perspective. Also, it's important to read, at least have some basic understanding of how economics and world economics work. So I would suggest reading Karl Marx, 1984, Animal Farm, also Critique of Communism, whether it is, so many, lectures of lectures on capitalism, things like this. These are all serious reading, which, will help us understand policy issues and what is happening, etc., in a more clear way. And I think insofar as podcast is concerned, now because I travel a lot, I get from Bangalore to Delhi, the flight is 2.5 hours. So I get to read new contemporary stuff. So I keep reading a lot of motivational stuff because every day I have to wake up with some kind of a personal or somebody else's challenge. So I try to keep reading a lot of motivational stuff. One book that has actually helped me pass through a lot of, in 2017 I had a lot of personal and professional issues. So one author who whose books really helped me understand was Ryan Holiday. There are two books which I would suggest any interested young person to read. One book is called Ego is the Enemy. The second book is titled Obstacle is the Way. I have actually suggested this to a lot of my friends. That book helped me understand a lot of things better. Podcast, there is one interesting podcast that I've come across recently. He's an Indian tech entrepreneur called Naval Ravikant. So I'm sure you have heard of him, and his podcast, again, Tim Ferriss show is very interesting. There's another channel that on YouTube called Ivan Carmichael. So he the best of the best speakers from around the world, motivators from around the world, quick bites, quick speeches of him are available on YouTube, Ivan Carmichael show. So this is a lot of learning, a lot of studying if you are interested. So these are things that I keep learning and reading all the time. So if you enjoy reading, you should be at it all the time.
I'm pretty sure that's an interesting syllabus that, a lot of our young viewers would have picked up today. To add to what both of you said, of course, the Constitution of India, I think a bare reading of the whole book will give a lot of insights into what our country is made of. Before we move into the last part of the show, we have one last question for Tejasvi from one of the audience.
Vanakkam Annamalai sir, Namaskar Tejasvi sir. Sir, I have two questions, both Tejasvi sir. One is the rapid fire fun question. So, yes, sir. So beach party or pool party, what is your idea of a good party?
Bharatiya Janata Party.
So, sir, with this question already Annamalai sir has answered. So, to you, sir, so how has your life changed after entering into politics?
A lot, actually. In fact, my professional life has changed drastically. Annamalai ji mentioned, lots of patience because you have to keep meeting so many people. Everyone you have to be very nice to, you have to meet everyone nicely, and there's no, you can't be rude to anybody, so you learnt a lot of patience, that's one thing. I wasn't as disciplined as I am now. Not that I'm great, at discipline today, but progressively I've gotten better because I've learned the importance and value of time. And I've also realized how much I'm able to do in 24 hours versus how little I was doing before. So managing time is something that has changed. Though my battle to wake up early is still something that I keep failing at every day. I think professionally those are two things that have changed. But personal life has not changed in any way. I still have share the same Netflix account that is co-owned by my friends. My YouTube premium account is still loaned by my friend. Even now, it's just the same group of friends we try to hang out with. But one thing that I'm really proud of that hasn't changed in my personal life is this. And this I say with a lot of conviction in my command. In the last 1.5 years after I have become an MP, there were multiple occasions at which I could have changed the way my personal life was. But today, I can tell with a lot of conviction and lot of pride that the clothes that I wear, the food that I eat, and the expenses for my personal expenses at home, every single rupee in the last 1.5 years, all of this is from my earning that comes from my law practice and not a single rupee from any other source. That is something. So that is something that gives me a lot of confidence and pride. Just a few days ago, I was at my chartered accountant's office when I was to file IT returns. And, you know, we were going through that expenses sheet. And it was like, you know, bought a shirt here, paid ice cream bill at Richie Rich, or, you know, something. So it's like, all of these are mobile phone, digital UPI transaction, car transactions for all of these, you know, personal choices. So he said, I have not seen a politician's expense sheet like this. So that's one thing I'm really proud of. And I keep saying this, you asked a question, Sumukh, in the very beginning, when people should enter politics, at what age, 20s, 30s, I feel it's very good, very right to be aspirational when you're 20s, 30s, you want to be a young leader, but it is very important to have a source of income that is apart from politics before you join politics. Because that way you will remain incorruptible. That way nobody can come and put a price tag on you. And today I can tell you, tomorrow if anything, you know, no person can walk into my office and say, I'm going to give you this kind of money and do this for me. Because I don't need that kind of money to lead my life. I have another source of income. So, yes, thank you.
Thank you for very candidly opening up about it. We've come towards the end of this conversation. I just want to ask both of you. Both of you entered, you know, professional politics more or less in the same period. You know, you've both been there for almost the same amount of time. In the time that you've been there, what is the most significant thing that you've seen? You know, it may be of a citizen or it may be a change in you. What is that one lesson, one significant thing that you have seen? If each of you could share that, I think that would be a good message before we end the conversation.
I'll answer the question two ways. One, within our party, and second, in the society per se. In our party, I've seen hope, especially in Tamil Nadu BJP, belief now. People literally believe the parties are on the verge of winning. That is important. The belief system has come in now. This is phenomenal, which encourages all of us to work much harder. Within the society, I see a sense of, a little bit sense of not fighting back. Across youngsters, across old people, they take life for what it is. Many a times they just don't stand up and fight. That I believe is a product of the education system we come out, product of the society that is shaping up. So this is a significant shift we have to do very, very fast and very, very effectively we got to do, where people can fight, personal crisis they can fight. Not literally fist fighting, they can overcome the odds. Professionals think they can overcome the odds, failures they overcome the odds, because suicides at one end is increasing. At one end people make stupid decisions just because they are not able to overcome something. So this is a larger thing when we travel, and like what he said, it requires a lot of time. You speak motivation stuff, you speak counseling, you talk a lot of time to them. So this is something I've seen, which is very significant for me. Because maybe as a police cop for 10 years, I got a little bit more insulated also. When I go out, I see, okay, maybe we are failing somewhere as a society, somewhere as an education place. This is the way I see it.
Tejasvi, your...
I think it's hope. Hope is something that I see every day. Hope is something that I see in every person who walks into our office. Hope in the system, hope for a better tomorrow, hope that things are going to be better than what it is today. And I must tell you, Sumukh, that my visits in Bihar, I'm sure he has visited as well, many of you would have visited. That gave me a lot of, changed the perspective in a lot of ways, because I went into very remote corners of Bihar. The guy from, say, Ara or Buxar has the same aspiration that the youth of, say, 21st century Bangalore or New Delhi or South Bombay has. He wants the same kind of quality of life. He is ready to put in more hard work than the South Bombay entitled guy, the South Bangalore, highly educated, entitled young people have. And I think in the next 20 years, if India will surge ahead, it will surge ahead on the basis of the hope and strength and hard work of those common, deprived, weak, humble background Indian youth. That is what I keep seeing every day. And especially because of my current role as the Yuva Morcha National President, I keep meeting young people every day. Every young person who walks into our office, I have my Bangalore South Yuva Morcha President Puneet Reddy here. He is going to be contesting the panchayat elections in 10 days from now, and he is going to win the elections. That's the sign of another aspirational youth. So we will have, this is the strength that I keep seeing every day, the strength of hope, the strength of aspiration. And I see this because I was reading this blog a few days ago by Lee Kuan Yew, the man who was instrumental in building modern day Singapore. He said that modern Singapore was built because of the hard work of the middle class, the first generation settlers in Singapore, because they knew the importance of hard work. They knew the importance of, integrity, discipline, and things like this. So this India of today is not the India where, you will be able to survive and go abroad, go about your life bandying about your surnames, about what your grandfather did and father did. This is the India where India will celebrate the story of a T. Natarajan. Right? All of us today, a few days back, Annamalai ji also had tweeted about T. Natarajan. He comes from a very remote village, 70 kilometers from Salem. Is now today celebrated as the Yorker King of India. You know what I like about him? Not that he is now the Yorker King of India, but after he got his IPL contract for the first time, he got an IPL contract for about 3 crore rupees. The first thing that he did, what is the basic instinct of any person? His mother runs a small chicken store in, I think it's called Panamenapetti or something. Very near a small village in Salem. She runs a small chicken store. If I would have got 3 crores, another person in his place would have got 3 crores. The first thing they would have done is to maybe get a flat in Chennai. Settle in your life. What he did? He launched T. Natarajan Academy for cricketers in that village because he wanted to give opportunities to other young people who come from that village, which he didn't have just a few years ago. T. Natarajan represents the hope, the aspiration of this new changing India. We all represent that aspiration and change. So I think every day that keeps us motivated, keeps us, this thing, the one thing that I've seen in the last 1.5 years is this, the feeling of hope that tomorrow is going to be better. And for that better, I'm ready to put in hard work today.
Well, thank you so much, both of you, for being very candid, very open, and also guiding a large section of the youth of our society who are watching today. I'm pretty sure all our viewers are very enriched after this discussion. Again, thank you to both of you, and Jai Hind.
Thank you so much to Annamalai ji again for coming here, gracing his the office and interacting with all of us. Thank you so much. Grateful.